Rav Alex, it's been such a long time since I saw you. It's good to see you again.
It's great to see you, Rav Menachem, and we're looking forward to Purim. So let's discuss a little bit about Purim. And one of the wonderful, wonderful biblical parallels we have is between Mordechai and Yosef. The one recalls the other. At the end of the Megillah, we see that Vayasar HaMelech et Tabato Asher Hivim Mehaman Vayitnala Mordechai, that Paro takes his ring away from Haman and gives it to Mordechai. It reminds us of Pharaoh, who does the same thing with Yosef. In fact, both stories are similar. We have a Jew in a foreign land, right, who rises to power, a king who can't sleep so well. In both cases, we have two courtiers who seem to get in trouble with the king, Bigtan and Teresh on the one side, the butler and the baker on the other side. And somehow they're part of the story about how this person, whether it's Mordechai or Yosef, rise up to greatness to become the leader of a foreign court. But then here's two very similar characters, right? And yet there's a big difference. At every point, Yosef seems to say that it's about God. Ki Elohim pitronim, Hashem has the solution to dreams. Or he says to his brothers, you aren't the ones who brought me here. It was Hashem who brought me here. But here in the Megillah, the name of God is never mentioned. Mordechai doesn't say, Baruch Hashem, doesn't say, you know, it was Hashem who saved the Jewish people. Where is Hashem in the Megillah?
You could ask the same thing, where's Hashem in our day-to-day lives? So I'm going to begin with your question and ask a more important question, I guess, one in methodology. When I study Megillat Esther, what assumption can I make about the author and his intent? Am I assuming that the author is expecting its reader to know the story of Yosef and make those connections? I think for sure. In other words, the author, Megillat Esther, wanted Rabbi Alex, oh my gosh, they're the same story.
I'd even say more than that. I think whoever wrote Megillat Esther wanted it to look like a real Tanakh book. He didn't write it in Aramaic like the book of Daniel. He wrote it in Hebrew. He referenced lots of biblical stories so that it would be put into the Tanakh.
Yeah. It's textual parallels and thematic parallels together. If I go back to Sefer Bereshit and ask myself, why is it that Yosef's attributing everything to God? Well, before Yosef are our forefathers. God spoke to Avram Avinu. Boy, he spoke to Avram Avinu and guided him. He'd galut revelation left and right. You know, chose him to become a nation, gave him guidance, direction. God spoke to Yitzchak, a key point in his life. God spoke to Yaakov when he was leaving, going into exile on his way down to Egypt. God spoke to our forefathers over and over again. So, of course, our forefathers saw God in every event in their life. It's interesting that even though God speaks to our forefathers all through Sefer Bereshit, he never speaks to the tribes. He never speaks once to Yosef or any of the tribes. Prophecy is over. Hidgalut is over. And the question is going to be, why is it that Yosef is attributing everything to God? Well, I call this a jump start. Meaning, when does God have to be involved with Hidgalut, what's called, I'll go into Chassidut, Nigle. When does God have to come and show himself? That's a jump start for people to recognize he's there. After the jump start, the car has to run on its own. And therefore, once Am Yisrael's beginning, once we have the children of Israel, once Yaakov has brought up his family, they know to find God even when God doesn't talk to them. And what Yosef is able to do, he sees all the events in his life. He notices, it can't be coincidence that my brothers throw me in the pit and these Midianim came and took me out and that, I had this dream and, these guys got thrown into jail and now we became a big shot. That has to be God. And putting together multiple events and saying, this can't be coincidental. God must be behind these events. What's God telling me through these events? That, I think, is Yosef's interpretation. And when the author of the Megillah wants us to connect the stories together, I think the main connection is, how do you find God in day-to-day life, maybe even especially in the diaspora where it's much harder to see God?
So what you're saying is that by referencing the Yosef story, Yosef who saw God in his life, now we understand that some of the coincidences in the Megillah actually are the act of God.
That's what the author wants the reader to do. Now, sometimes a message is much stronger when it's sublime, when it's called obfuscation. I hide something because I want the reader to find it. So we purposely don't mention the name of God. It's so obvious we should. If the book is canonized, Chazal for sure understood that that's the message of the book. But by hiding God's name and maybe renaming the key hero, Esther, why she's called Esther, you can argue. That's a lot of opinions. But Chazal say, Esther min HaTor minayim, v'nochi Aster Aster panayim mikem. In other words, how do you find God, the hand of God? That goes back to Shirat Hazinu. Therefore, the Haggadah, in my opinion, not Haggadah, the Megillah is purposely hiding God's name because it wants the reader to find God, but the reader has to find God on his own. And that's a message for all, you know, for not just for the Megillah, but for all our life and our celebration. How do we find God when God doesn't appear to us day to day? We have to find him in nature. We have to find God in our history and act accordingly.
So we will, on Purim, try and look for Hashem behind the mask, behind Hashem behind our lives, and that will be the message that we will have to uncover.
Ad shekei nida.
Ad shekei nida.